The next slide should tell you that today's lesson is going to be the conclusion of our series called Tough as Nails. And so we started out by looking at what's it look like to kind of read through the words of Jesus and those difficult words. So we started out with like not doubting. Thank you, Jeremy. We started out with not doubting, and then we eventually transitioned into the words of Jesus on the cross. And so 2 weeks ago, we looked at, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And we talked about the fact that forgiveness is oftentimes difficult for us. And we think about the fact that Jesus, hanging on the cross, is able to say to those who put him on the cross, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And you know those people who have caused you the most hurt? Yeah, it may have been intentional on their part at times, but we need to forgive them. Otherwise, we carry around a load of bitterness, and it eats us up. And so we talked a little bit about that. Last week, as we had an opportunity to be together, we talked about Jesus' words on the cross to the thief that said, today, you will be with me in paradise. Now, we looked at the fact that whenever Jesus' crucifixion started, we talked about the fact that it was like 9 o'clock in the morning when they started the crucifixion. And we read in the gospel accounts that both of the thieves, one on his right and one on his left, both of them were mocking and ridiculing Jesus. By the time we get to noon, we find that the one thief is saying, wait a second here, there's something different about Jesus. He's not guilty, we are. And he says, will you remember me? He asked Jesus, will you remember me in your kingdom? And Jesus says to him, today you'll be with me in paradise. And we talked about that person. That person who you might look at and say they would never want to know about Jesus. We all have those people that we kind of think are that person, right? That person who is like opposed to everything that you stand for. That person who you think is like the farthest away from God and has set himself up maybe or herself up against God at times, has mocked and ridiculed you for your faith, whatever that might be. For you teens, think of the person in school that you think, man, if there's anybody that would not want to know about Jesus, it is that person. You know, that thief on the cross, he had done something worthy of being crucified. That was not just your average thief. This was a wicked man, and yet he had a turning point in his life where he saw Jesus for who he really was. You know, I asked the question last week, how many of you were at one time that person? And a lot of us can say, you know what, I was that person. I was that person opposed to God. I was that person who kind of set myself up against those who said that they were for God. I was that person, and you know what? There was a turning point in my life too. And the whole point of that was to say this. No one is off limits to the gospel. No one. Let that sink in. No one is off limits to the gospel. So when you're thinking about, hey, who can I invite? Now, I want you to be strategic. Yes, I do. I want you to think about, pray about, hey, who can I invite? But I'll just say this. Like, if you overthink this, you'll end up inviting no one, and everyone should be open to the gospel, right? Everyone should have that opportunity. So don't like limit yourself in saying like, I need to invite the perfect person. Let me give you a descriptor of the perfect person. Here is the person that all of you should feel free to invite. This person should be breathing. All right, good. There you go. That's the descriptor of the perfect person to invite. If they are alive, they need to know Jesus if they don't yet know him. And if they do need Jesus, we need to be the ones that are willing to tell them. And so I just strongly encourage you, like, as we think about Easter, this is a perfect opportunity. And it's not that, like, I don't know, sometimes there's this kickback against or pushback against like a huge emphasis on Easter. Let me just tell you why there's a huge emphasis on Easter. And I kind of mentioned it earlier. Everyone at least partially considers the possibility of going to church on Easter and Christmas. And if there is someone who might be considering the possibility of going to church, here's the only thing I care about. I want them to go to a church that's going to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. They don't have to come here. If by you inviting someone, it causes them to think to go somewhere else, I'm okay with that, as long as that place that they go shares the gospel. Because I want people to hear about Jesus. Like, and we're going to look again at Jesus while he's on the cross and see some of his final words. And I hope that that kind of puts within you a gumption to say, you know what? I may have never invited someone in my entire life, but this week is going to be the week I do it. I strongly urge you to do that. So today's tough as nails words of Jesus, I'm actually going to use two of them, but I only put the final one here, which is, it is finished. We're going to start with a different phrase that Jesus said while he was on the cross. We're in Matthew chapter number 27 in verse 45. It says, from the sixth hour. Now we remember that we started, the crucifixion was started at the third hour, which was about 9 a.m. And so the sixth hour would have been noon. So from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, that had been 3 p.m., darkness came over all the land. And at about the ninth hour, Jesus cried in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means this, my God, why have you forsaken me? If I was to ask you this morning, how many of you have ever felt forsaken by God? I think a large number of you would probably acknowledge that at one point in your life, you felt forsaken by God. Now, I think we're going to be able to see as we go throughout the morning that at those times you felt forsaken by God, you never were. But Jesus, when he utters these words and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? I want you to be reminded that Jesus could not speak a lie. When he says, why have you forsaken me? It is not just a feeling. At this moment, God had turned his back on his son. And Jesus felt the full weight of that. If you can imagine truly having been abandoned by God, and like I said, there have been, I'm sure that many of you across this room today have felt abandoned by God, but I want to assure you, you never have been. But Jesus says, why have you forsaken me? And the simplest answer is this. Jesus was taking the weight of the sin and the punishment of all mankind upon himself. And the scriptures teach us over and over and over again that sin separates mankind from God. And so as Jesus takes the weight of that sin and the punishment that all of us in our sin deserve, he was forsaken in that moment by God. Now that's so hard to wrap a human mind around. How God in the flesh could be forsaken by God. But you got to remember, and this is part of, I was having a discussion with a gentleman yesterday, and we were talking a little bit about theology, and I said, I don't understand everything about theology. I don't have my mind fully wrapped around everything. There are some things that I just can't understand. But what I do understand is that as Jesus took the punishment of all mankind, that weight was very real. And that separation was very real. If you have ever felt separated from God, I want to let you know what that is. Any true separation from God can only come as a result of sin, because sin always separates. And so there are times that God allows us to feel the weight of how much our sin can break fellowship with God. Now, we're going to see here in just a little bit that Jesus came to bridge that gap, right? So we have to understand history. How many of you like history? Oh, a good number of you, actually. Okay. So it's important to understand history at this point. The history, biblical history, tells us this, that when Adam and Eve were created, they were created sinless, and they had a perfect relationship with God, unbroken fellowship. But when they chose to eat of that forbidden fruit, they brought sin into the world, and sin, as we see here on the screen, sin separates mankind from God. And so that separation is very real, but it doesn't need to be real. And here's why it doesn't need to be real. And we're going to see this again and again this morning, because your sin debt, the thing that separates you from a holy God, your sin debt has been paid in full by Jesus Christ on the cross. It is so important that you realize that, yes, while Jesus took the full weight of all of our sin upon himself, and he truly was able to utter those words like, "Why have you forsaken me?" He uttered those words so that you never would have to experience that, so that you could have full fellowship with God. Now, let's back up a little bit, and let's look at what Jesus experienced throughout his ministry, because I think that's so key to understand the perfect relationship he had with the Father. We find out in Luke 2 that as Jesus is a child, he is growing in wisdom and in stature. And look, he's growing in favor with not only mankind, but also with God. He had that perfect relationship all the way from childhood. We see him at his baptism. Whenever he goes to John the Baptist and he says, I need to be baptized of you. And John's like, "What? Hold on a second, I think this is a little backwards. Like, I think, Jesus, you probably ought to be baptizing me." And he says, "No, I need to do this. So please allow this to be so." And it says that after Jesus' baptism, as he's coming up out of the water, the heavens opened. He sees the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on Jesus. And a voice from heaven says this, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." So Jesus, as he begins his ministry, he hears these words, like these affirming words. "This is my Son. I love my Son. My Son is doing my work. I am so pleased in my Son." And Jesus is hearing these words. He goes and he's tempted of the devil. And three times, in three different ways, Satan tries to convince Jesus to turn his back on God and to give in to the temptation, and he doesn't do it, and he says, "Get behind me, Satan." And immediately after that, it says the devil left him. And check it out, the angels came and attended to him. And he had to have known at that moment that he had the approval of his Father, that the Father was looking down and he was seeing what was being done by his Son, and he gives him, if you would, just kind of a pat on the back, a round of applause. "Yes, my Son, you are doing my work. I am well pleased in what you are doing," and the angels are ministering to him. You see a little bit later on in his ministry that Jesus says this. He's talking to the people, that the disciples and those that he is teaching, and he says, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man," in other words, "when you have crucified me, then you'll know that I am the one that I claim to be," because he claimed to be the Messiah. He claimed to be the Holy One. He claimed to be the Son of God. "So I want you to know that whenever you put me on that cross, you're going to know that I am the one that I claim to be, and that I don't do anything on my own, but I speak just what the Father has taught me. The one who sent me is with me, and check this out, he has not left me alone, for I always do what pleases him." So he has gone through his ministry, and every time, at every turn, he is getting the approval of the Father because he is doing exactly what the Father wants. And he says, "Listen, the Father hasn't left me alone. I'm doing the things that please him." As he gets close to the crucifixion, Jesus says, "My heart is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No. It was for this very reason that I came to this hour. So, Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. Jesus has stated, and I'm just going to back up to this verse one more time. He has stated, listen, the Father hasn't left me alone. I am pleasing the Father. He gets to the point where he knows he's looking to the cross, and he says, "What should I ask that I don't have to go?" And he says, no. This is the reason that I came. I know that my purpose in coming to the earth is to accomplish the salvation of all mankind. So yes, this is going to be difficult, but I know this pleases the Father. And since it pleases the Father, he says, listen, I'm not left alone. But then we see at the time when he pleases the Father the most, when he has accomplished the work that he was sent here to do because of this weight of sin upon him, he cries out, my God, I have never felt forsaken by you before, but why have you forsaken me now? These are true feelings, folks. And I know it's easy to say, well, that was Jesus. He knew what was going on. He understood that. I want you to understand the emotional pain that Jesus was experiencing in this time. To have taken the weight of your sin, which you have known those times when your sin has caused the separation between you and God, right? You have known those times. And that is something Jesus had never experienced. He had never experienced any separation, not even a degree of separation from his Father. And you'll notice that most of the time, whenever Jesus talks about the Father, when he talks about God, he doesn't say God, he says Father. But in this moment, he's God, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why. Jesus was abandoned. I want you to get this. This is so key. Jesus was abandoned so that no one would ever have to be abandoned again. Jesus was abandoned by his Father. Abba, Father. Daddy, as Jesus would call him, was abandoned so that you never have to experience that abandonment. Some of you have experienced that at the hands of an earthly father. I get that. Some of you have maybe never experienced true love of a father. I get that, and I know that that's painful. I want you to understand you don't ever have to experience the abandonment of your heavenly Father. Jesus bridged that gap. He took the full weight of sin and the punishment for sin upon himself so that you never, ever have to feel abandoned. In 1 John 2, and in verse 2, here's what we read. It says, Jesus is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. The King James would use the big word. He is the propitiation for our sins. And all that means is exactly what is said here. The atonement has been paid. It is the sin debt has been paid. You have been brought into right fellowship with God. The opportunity for right fellowship has been made because Jesus is the sacrifice for our sins. And not just for ours only, as they wrote back then, but also for the sins of the whole world. He took all that sin so that you would not have to experience the punishment of any sin. Another verse, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 19, says that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. Why can God not count your sins against you? Because he counted them against his Son when he hung on the cross. The perfect, spotless Lamb of God took your punishment so that you don't have to experience that. And I know that as we think back to the cross, a lot of times we think back with a very somber face and kind of thinking about what Jesus had to go through. And even as we sang a couple of the songs, you know, it kind of brings the emotions, at least for me, it brings them to the surface as far as what Jesus has done. But I want you to know that his great love for us, he did that so that you never had to experience separation. He did this willingly. Jesus even said, I lay down my own life. No one takes it from me. I lay it down myself. No one is making him do this. But he does this so that the Father doesn't need to count your sins against you. This is so key, folks. And if you have never gotten this before, if you have never fully understood the gospel, I pray that today is the day that you get it. I pray that today is the day that you realize that if nothing is done about your sin, that your sin will separate you eternally from God. But the fact is that Jesus paid your sin debt. And by placing your faith in that finished work, his blood is applied to your account. Your payment is made. And so he says, that's what God was doing. And check out this. We remind ourselves that he's abandoned, so no one has to be. And we find in verse 21 of the same passage that God made him, talking about Jesus, who had no sin. And therefore, that's why I say, he had never even experienced one degree of separation from his Father. He made him who had no sin to be sin for us. He loves you. Why did he do it? So that in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. So that whenever Jesus looks at you, he sees paid in full. When Jesus looks at you, he sees the righteousness of God. When Jesus looks at you, he doesn't see someone that needs to be separated from him. He sees someone who is right with him. And so we see a very, very important lesson being taught, and I've reiterated it time and time again. Why was Jesus crying out, Father, why have you forsaken me? It's because in his abandonment, he made it so that none of us ever have to be abandoned again. It's finishing what he talked about in these verses that we're all so familiar with. That God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. The very next verse, which is oftentimes forgotten because everyone knows John 3:16, reminds us that God didn't send Jesus into the world, or he didn't send his Son into the world to condemn the world. He actually sent Jesus into the world to save the world through him. He experienced that abandonment so that you don't have to. So we see this, my God, why have you forsaken me? Here's why. Because God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting their sins against them. That's crazy, folks. That's crazy. Who does that? Jesus. I enjoy being here as part of this church family. I think we have grown in our love for one another over the course of the last year plus. But I have a confession to make, and it's a true statement that I feel needs to be known. I wouldn't give my life for I don't think I'd give my life for you. I would like to think that in the right situation, maybe I would. I'd like to think that I would. But it'd be tough. Because I'll be honest, I have a couple of kids and I love them deeply. And it would be tough for me to ever get to the point where I say, yeah, you know what? I'd give my life for you guys. I hope that I would. But I just got to be honest, I don't know that I would. And I doubt that you would give your life for me. And that's okay. The point is this, the depth of our love for one another doesn't go nearly as deep as the depth of God's love for you and for me and for that person that we talked about last week. He reconciled the world to himself in Christ, not counting their sins against them. Craziness. So we move back to Jesus on the cross. It says that later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I'm thirsty. And a jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it. They put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and they lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head, and he gave up his spirit. It is finished. The work that I have come here to accomplish, it is finished. And this phrase, "it is finished," it is actually one Greek word. We translate it into three words in English, "it is finished," but it's the Greek word tetelestai. And that Greek word literally means paid in full. When Jesus uttered the words, "it is finished," on the cross, he was saying this: the sin debt of all mankind is paid in full. I don't care how wicked you are today, Jesus has paid for your sins. I don't care how much you have set yourself up against God, Jesus has paid your debt in full. It's completed. It is finished. And so we're able to read these words and understand their meaning, that if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, these four wonderful words, you will be saved. So here's where it's at, folks. Jesus was abandoned so that no one else would ever have to be. He paid the debt in full, tetelestai. It is finished, paid in full. I have this question for you, and this is my only question for you today. Is that payment applied to your account? The way that that payment gets applied to your account is by faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. You know, Pizza Hut in Worcester has a buffet that they have, all-you-can-eat buffet. There's a fixed price for that buffet. If I was to count the number of people that are in here, and I was to go into Worcester and I was to pay for all of you to have the pizza buffet, and there's a salad bar and everything like that. I'm not sure why anybody is interested in that, but I sometimes say things out loud I probably shouldn't. But if I was to pay for every single one of you, here's what I know. Some of you wouldn't go. "I don't want to drive into Worcester. It's kind of a little bit far away. I don't really feel like eating pizza. I don't really feel like salad today." I could pay the price for you to eat and you never experience the enjoyment of that meal. And one of the saddest realities is this: Jesus has paid the sin debt of all mankind, and billions of people never experience that, because they've never had that moment of faith where they reached out to the loving God who sent his one and only son for them and said, "Jesus, I want you to be my Savior. I turn from my sin and I turn to you." And so today, if you haven't done that, today's the day. You do not have a restored relationship with God until you place your faith in him. And I want to talk about the difference between just simply believing facts about something and having faith in something, just real quick. So I want you to know this, that if you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, you believe that he was buried and you believe that he rose again, and you intellectually acknowledge those things, so you know those things to be true, I want to let you know that intellectual knowledge is not the same thing as faith. It's not the same thing as saving faith, folks. Because here's the truth of the matter, and you can read about this in the scriptures. The demons, Satan, they know intellectually everything that you know. In fact, they know a lot more than you know. An intellectual knowledge of facts about Jesus does not put you in a restored relationship with him. When you are willing to acknowledge, you know what, I am a sinner in need of Jesus. I am a sinner in need of Jesus' payment applied to my account. And you in faith reach out to him. And there's no magic words. If you've been taught at some point in your life that there are like these magic words, that as long as you say these magic words, then you're going to be in a right relationship with God. I want to let you know that it is never about magic words. It is about the faith that you express in saying, Jesus, I turn from my sin and I turn to you. So they talk about the difference between here and here. The about 16 to 18 inches that can be the difference between your eternity in heaven or your eternity in hell. So an intellectual understanding here needs to come down to a heart faith here. And when we talk about this, I strongly encourage you to evaluate, to say, have I only intellectually assented to those things that I know to be true? Or have I genuinely said, Jesus, I want you as my Savior. Save me today. So, Father, I pray over these, your people. I pray that there is one here today who maybe for years of their life, they have lived in the same reality that I lived in for a lot of years of my life. I knew a lot about you, Jesus. I could have quoted scriptures that told me about you. I could have done a lot of things that would have allowed a lot of people to think that I had a right relationship with you. But I thank you, Jesus, that there came a day in my life when you reached out and you helped me to realize that I had never turned from who I was, from my sin, and in faith reached out to you. So I thank you for that day, and I pray that if there is 1, 2, 5, 10 in here today who have intellectually given their approval to a lot of the things that we have talked about, I pray that if they have never in their heart said, Jesus, I want you as my Savior. This isn't just me reciting some words. This isn't just me saying something that I think that I ought to say. This is me from my heart saying, Jesus, I want that payment you made on the cross to be applied to my account. If there is one in here today who has not yet made that decision, I want to just strongly encourage you, even as I am praying now, just make that faith statement for yourself. Reach out to him and say, Father, forgive me. Father, I want the payment Jesus made to be applied to my account. I believe intellectually these things about Jesus. And now I'm placing my faith in him as the only possible sacrifice. Can I just ask, and there's nobody looking around right now, can I just ask, is there anyone today that says, you know what? I have made that step from an intellectual understanding about Jesus to a faith in Jesus. Is there anyone that would say, I made that step today? Would you just raise your hand real quick so that I can pray for you? You say, I made that step, that change from an intellectual understanding. I see that hand. Anyone else? Anyone else say, I've made that decision today from an understanding about Jesus to a faith in Jesus. So, Father, I pray over this one who has said, I go from an understanding to a faith in you. I pray, Lord, for them as they continue to walk in you and to learn from you. And then I want to transition now, Father, to an understanding that there are thousands of people in our community who need to know you. And I pray that now those who do know you would be able to make this transition and be able to say, you know what? No one needs to experience the abandonment that Christ felt on the cross. He took that for me so that I could have a right relationship, and he took that for all mankind. So I pray that you'd allow this to propel us to go into our community, to talk to our friends, to our neighbors, to our family members, and share with them that Jesus has paid the debt in full. He has said, it is finished, tetelestai, paid in full. Help us to reach out this week as we know that some people's minds are already going to be thinking about you and what you have done. So I pray that you would challenge us to get into this community and make a difference. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.